We'll move on to the next talk, that is on role of adaptive immunity in COVID-19 infection. Due to personal emergency, Dr. Amit is not able to deliver. This talk will be delivered by Dr. Chandrasekhar. Can I have an introductory slide, sir? Yes. Dr. Chandrasekhar is the medical director of Chantry Rheumatology and Immunology Center and Research Bangalore. He's a vice president of Indian Rheumatological Association from 2019. He's a president for Indian Rheumatological Association of Karnataka chapter from 2019, general secretary for Society of Inflammation Research, and he's the key person behind the society and most of the activities or his thoughts. The managing trustee of the Immunology and Arthritis Research and Education Trust. He's an executive director for Chantry Journals. Faculty and Program Coordinator for Post-EMD Fellowship in Immunology and Rheumatology in Chantry Rheumatology and Immunology Center. He has received various awards. In 2015, Sir C.V. Raman State Award for Young Scientist from the Government of Karnataka State Council of Science and Technology for the year 2013. 2019, IMA Pune Annual Enabler Oration Award and IME Maharashtra State 59th MASCON and 29th MultiCON in 2019 awards. In 2013, Oration Award for Indian Rheumatological Association. In 2000, he received Dr. Malika Reddy Oration Award from the Association of Physicians of India. He has more than 100 publications. His special areas of interest include autoimmune diseases, recurrent pregnancy loss, in silico modeling. So with this introduction, I over to Dr. Chandrasekhar to deliver his talk on role of adaptive immunity in COVID-19 infection. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Padmavalli. One reminder, I am a substitute player. I have very limited time to work on the slides, and there could be here and there small slide issues. You need to excuse on that. And basically, as a clinician with a translation to the immunology, I will be discussing on some of the key areas, how we look at the disease from the adaptive immune response perspective, vis-a-vis to the possible complications, etc. So let me begin the story with the how exactly human, or for that matter, any living organism handles an infection. It is a simple flowchart. When infection occurs, you see the antigen presenting cell picking up those infections, sensitizes T cells, also to some extent the B cells. With the help of T cells, they sensitize the B cells. T cells also get sensitized to the infection. They kill the infection. B cell secretes the antibody, which in turn enables the infections, blocks the new infections, also promotes the clearance of infection. That's the good story when the infection completely clears from the body. So that's how any infection, including virus, are going to be taken care of. And what's the little difference when it comes to COVID? COVID, they use ACE2 receptor along with TMR, PSS2 receptors to internalize themselves to the cells. ACE2 being predominantly present in the respiratory endothelium as well as in the endotheliums of the vasculature, they become the targets of these viruses whenever it goes for an initial aerosol delivery to the respiratory tract. They first infect the respiratory tract. When it goes for a secondary viremia, they can involve and include various other organs where they enter it through these receptors, internalize like any other virus, unwinds its genomes, takes the replications through the assistance of the host cell, assemble themselves and sprouts out to generate more viruses. More the viruses, it spreads to the next and subsequent cells. So in a nutshell, in a clinical scenario, in the incubation period or incubation or a pre-symptomatic phase, gradually the virus replicates, the viral genome multiplies. Simultaneously, body tries to raise its antibody. If it is successful, patient may be either asymptomatic, may have mild to moderate disease. unsuccessfully mounted response, the illness may go further, and where he may need hospitalization, may develop shortness of breath, may develop acute respiratory distress syndrome, subsequently viremic shock, needing varieties of treatment, either successfully recover or may land up in death, actually. So there is a way a virus translates through the clinical scenarios. In a clinical scenario, we have a pre-symptomatic phase, symptomatic phase, which could be mild to moderate, severe, and then they go for critical illness. So how it really interacts with an adaptive immune response, or adaptive immune response tries to work on viral defense. So as I said, once the infection occurs, they are taken up by the dendritic cells. They engulf them, process them, present it to the varieties of cells. You have TH cells, TFH cells, along with the CTL and Treg cells. They secrete cytokine productions. You generate memory T cells, memory B cells. And also you have B cells, which results in plasma cells, develop antibodies. Very successful. The story is a happy ending. Patient recovers with limited sequelae or with a sort of some of additional sequelae, but does recover when things go straight. When adaptive immune response very balancedly act with a pickup of the virus, sensitizing the cells that are required for the respective response. Response are a well-regulated and well-balanced response. There goes the outcome being good. I think previous 4 to 5 lectures have described how a T cell, how a T regulatory cells, how TH17 and TH9 cells, when their regulation goes out of control, they may result in collateral damage in addition to clearing the infections. So the question comes is how the adaptive immune response work favorably. When it is working favorably, T cells destroys the pathogen infected cells. B cell produces antibodies and targets the pathogenic antigens, mark them for eliminations, secretes varieties of cytokines which assist in process of recruiting, maintaining T and B cell activation, proliferation, and varieties of cytokines which predominantly include IL-6, IFN gamma, TNF-alpha, which helps in overall assisting the infective cells eliminations. And we require vasculatures they are made permeable so that the cells are recruited at the site of infections, along with the support of both innate as well as the innate proteins components. It effectively eliminate the infected cells, infected tissues, and clearance. But we have seen, and the trouble for us in any of the clinical scenario are the 5 to 25% of the patient who either progress to have a severe illness or critical illness. This 5 to 25% depends on the population at risk. That elderly population have a higher risk of developing into severe disease. Individual with the higher comorbidities have a risk to develop into the severe disease. Younger patients are less likely to have a severe disease. And these are the observations that we have made. And why, when 75 to 95% of the patient could successfully eliminate, why few of them land into the severe disease? And I dwell on how the adaptive immune response and their dysregulations could result in the development of severe disease. So what goes wrong? Why does things go wrong in this 5 to 25% resulting in a collateral damage or problems? So what may happen is, as it is said, that translations, assembly plans, recruitments, activation of specific cells are not happening as it is planned because of the varieties of reasons. The things may turn out to be disaster, either not giving an adequate response, resulting in severe viremia, giving an adequate response, which is more than adequate, resulting in the cytokine storm. So the things can go wrong on either way. The things can go wrong by the inadequate response. Things can go wrong by unwanted response. So from the clinical perspective, we figure out these 5 to 25% of the patients by a few of the markers. One of the markers is excess of neutrophilia with lymphopenia, what we otherwise called as elevated neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. There are enough in literature to suggest that higher the NLR ratio, more likely the patient is going to have a severe disease, moderate to severe disease. As the number of NLR, as the NLR increases, the proportionately the chance of patient landing up into a requirement of oxygen or into ICU increases. Similarly, increase in lactate and LDH also suggest a tendency towards developing the severe illness. Elevating C-reactive protein, C-reactive protein rising more than 10 times at 25 to 35 milligram per liter is taken as a cutoff. When they rise above this point, the chance of patient or individual moving to a severe disease high. Raised ferritin, rising IL-6, rising ACE2 or D-dimer are considered as one of the hallmark or a biomarkers which suggest a patient infected with COVID may result and move towards a higher chance of developing a severe disease. So here you can see that some of them represents the signs and features of adaptive immune response going wrong. So let me take step by step. What that happens with reference to T cells? What has been observed with reference to T cells in a patient who are infected by COVID? And in a patient, especially in adults, there is a gradual depletion of T cells in the peripheral circulation. The T cell number slowly drops down, and in some, it has even come up to the 3% to 2%. Versus the more is the depletion, more likely the patient is likely to have a severe disease. So it has been well observed in an asymptomatic patients and children tend to preserve these peripheral T cell counts in a good number. As long as the peripheral T cell counts are good, the patients or the individual developing a good or a very good response is much better. So lymphopenia is one of the indicator for the worsening of NLR and worsening of the disease. Why does lymphopenia occur? It's multifactorial. One of them is said to be because of the redistributive effect or apoptotic loss of the lymphocyte. This could be either triggered by the virus or triggered by the immune response, the virus triggers it. This is one of the way the virus loves to learn or learns to escape out of the adaptive immune response cells. Or there is otherwise a possibility of a altered or a reduced mobilization of lymphocyte from the bone marrow. It is either because of IL-6, excess IL-6 production, or by the blockade of lymphopoiesis by varieties of factors could another reason why there could be lymphopenias. And certainly sure that as we know that it is the elderly who are responsible for, who are likely to develop the lymphopenia, likely to develop the complications and sequelae. It is said to be as a part and parcel of immunosenescence. In immunosenescence, as we know, the number of diverse naive T cells repertoire are reduced. With the reduction in diverse naive T cell repertoire, which is a part and parcel of aging, results in scarcity of naive T cells. That could be one of the reasons responsible for an uncoordinated adaptive response. I mean, in the previous four to five lectures, you have heard that a response, a immunological response, either on the self protein or on the infective organisms or any others, needs a coordinated cascade pathways. It needs a step-by-step coordination. Anywhere an uncoordinated or a discoordination occurs, the adaptive response is going to either have a heightened response or a reduced response. So as a consequence of which, one may result in severe disease. So the lack of naive T cells is said to be one of the reasons for T cell depletion, especially in the elderly, responsible for an uncoordinated adaptive response resulting in more severe disease. The question that comes perpetually is the T cell reduction, is it because of the destruction of the T cells, or is it because of the lack of productions, or is it because of the sequestrations? And most of the observation have clearly shown that T cell reductions are transient. And we have seen that as the patient moves towards recovery, the NLR ratio starts improving. The NLR ratio starts moving towards normalcy of 1.5 to 2. The lymphocyte counts increases. One of the earliest indication what I have observed in my clinical setting is As the lymphocyte count starts increasing, the patient's chance of recovery towards getting better improvises. So it supports that probably the T cells are sequestrated rather than destroyed. T cell production might have been transiently hampered, might be another responsible factor for the lymphopenia. The lymphopenia could be an indicator that the adaptive immune response, the T cell response, TH response, and TFH response, concentrations may not be adequate enough for the amount of viremia that has set in, amount of viral infection that has set in, could be the reason for worse the disease in either direction. So the one another question that is still in the mind, I think this was discussed even in yesterday, whether T cell has a good enduring immune memory. Is T cell immune response is enduring? If it is, so how long it lasts? When we vaccinate in an individual who don't develop an adequate antibody response, does he get an adequate T cell immunity against the viruses? I mean, this is a question which still need to be answered, but there are studies which says yes, probably some of them have a robust T cell immune memory. And if they get a robust T cell immune memory, even without adequate amount of antibody production, may have a good immune response. So there are several reasons which can result in failed T cell immunity. One is because of the variation in viral target, or the severity may also develop because the variation of viral target, as I said in the very beginning, the virus can infect endothelial cells which express EC receptors, and there are various other cells which do express the similar receptors in addition to the respiratory endothelium, in contrast to some of the specific respiratory viruses like RSV, H1N1, etc., where the infection restrains or restricts themselves more to only to the respiratory endothelium and respiratory epithelium, the chance of them going to a more of a higher sequelae or higher, severe diseases are less likely compared to COVID. One of the reasons probably the severity may be because of enhanced viral target, and as a result of which you need a wider breadth of T cell response. And if the breadth and magnitude of T response are higher, then the chance of patient recovering is better. And this has been very well observed in the patient who recovered from a severe disease have more wider representation of T cell response. So that what it means is T cell when adequately compromised and to have a wider response against the different infected cells, there is a chance and a possibility of patient being good. So the T cell magnitude of response, breadth of response is seen to be higher in a patients who have recovered and who had a severe disease, which is compared to asymptomatic disease, because as you know, the adaptive response increases its breadth and magnitude only when it is challenged. If you have a mild disease, if the disease or the infection has been well sequestrated and well compartmentalized, the chance of getting a wide breadth T cell response is not there. So that's what is very well observed by most of these studies, which has looked into the breadth and magnitude of T cell response. So one of the other things which we had was pre-exposure protective. If the patient was exposed to a COVID-like organisms, COVID-like virus earlier, this is one of the things which we thought that Indians are more protected because of the prior exposure to the COVID-like infection, vis-a-vis compared to the European counterpart, where we had a second wave, with a second wave which came earlier than Indian waves. We thought that probably it is because of the exposure to some of these COVID-like infections may be responsible for the milder cases. But this presumption was wrong, and it led to the disaster, because I think probably one of the reason why we maybe slowed down in vaccination and other program may be the responsible factor for the letting the second wave on. I mean, it's a presumption, but probably that may be one of the reason we thought that we are pre-exposed to some of the COVID-like organisms, that pre-existing T-cell response may be helpful, but that's not always the fact, because the T-cell response are highly antigen-specific. We always compare it to the immunoglobulin response. So that being the case, pre-exposure to the T-cell response might have been not as protective as it could be the viral specific. Excuse me, I think there is some noise from somewhere, if it can be silenced. So in a cell-mediated immunity, so as I mentioned, the SARS-CoV gets recognized, and once the multiple viral replication goes for immune escape, goes for higher viruses, and if the innate immune response produces adequate type 1 interferon, inhibits viral replication, can eliminate at this point. If it is not possible, then it may go for aberrant activation of monocyte macrophages, increased neutrophils, functionally impaired dendritic cells, resulting in exhausted and natural killer cells, may, as a compensatory response, elevate a pro-inflammatory cytokine response, resulting in cytokine storm. Again, antigen presentation to T cells, but the T cell, if it goes for a lymphopenia and exhaustion, may allow for the expansion of the virus, viremia, resulting in further spread of infection, resulting in heightened immune responses. So there is a two break mechanisms wherein the one is a possibility of the failed adequate innate immune response resulting in activation of the other group of cells like monocyte, macrophage, neutrophils, especially with NETosis. I mean, there are studies which clearly says the enhanced NETosis is seen in patients who develop autoimmune. And there are functionally impaired DCs which don't present adequately could be the reason of resulting in severe clinical manifestations. So what are the other markers of prognosis? We have lactate and lactate dehydrogenase, LDH increase, that occurs because of hypoxia, as well as the altered metabolic process, both in endothelium as well as in the lymphocytes. Elevating C-reactive protein signals the deviating cytokine preference, because cytokines, if move towards IL-6, as well as moving towards the TNF-alpha, which is supposed to be not a good or a potential good response against the viruses. Viruses being a cytoplasmic microorganisms, the best of the immune response is to be an interferon-driven response. Interferons produces less C-reactive protein compared to IL-6 and TNF-alpha. The rising C-reactive protein is one of the surrogate marker of the cytokines moving towards IL-6 and TNF. So that deviating cytokine preference is something which suggests in clinical, with the elevating C-reactive protein, that probably the infection is moving towards a cytokine storm. Similarly, the raised ferritin, which occurs because of tissue destruction, which suggests that if the ferritin rises, there is a massive tissue destruction, and the macrophage activation, as I showed in the previous figure, macrophage activation resulting in MAC-like syndrome or a mass-like syndrome could also be another reason for the patients moving towards a severe COVID-like infections. So the altered cytokine response like IL-6 and TNF, high viral load, altered or heightened activation of adaptive immune response, development of tissue damage like DAMs, PAMs, triggering a cytokine response, hypoxia-inducing peripheral damage, resulting in hypoxia-induced factor, HIF, which all starts triggering what we call as the SIRS, wherein the adaptive immunity totally drives macrophage, neutrophil, lymphocytes, along with protein mediators, continued resulting in endothelial damage, platelets, varieties of other systems, resulting in multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. So this is one of the way how a disease with adaptive immune response is not adequately mounted or not appropriately coordinated can result in systemic inflammatory response syndromes and sepsis. So in addition to that, as I said, the COVID has a tendency to include the endothelial tissue, as a result of which thrombosis is said to be one of the factors. The viral spike protein identify AC receptor, resulting in dysregulations and dysproteinemias, resulting in a lot of inflammation in vascular injuries, and promotes the possibility of thrombosis. And also there is a lot of fibrin degradation, activation of platelets, and this in turn raises both D-dimer as well as ACE2. So now it's very clear that these markers, which have been identified as one of the perfect biomarkers, clinically, to reflect a patient moving towards cytokine storm, clearly suggest that there is an aberrant or an altered immunological response, especially from the adaptive immune response, resulting in the patient moving towards severe disease. So to compensate that, I think there are varieties of immune interventions were tried. Anti-IL-6, initially we thought it is a success story, but the study from Roche and other products suggest that it's not such a potential drugs, but certainly it has helped in some of the patients who were moving towards IL-6 driven storm. IL-1 beta, the other success story is a JAK2 inhibitors, where both tofacitinib as well as baricitinib has been used. And the overall outcome with both the tofa as well as the baricitinib has shown a significant and a good improvement. IFN beta therapy spray as well as the IL-2 IL-7 therapies has been tried, and even anti-TNF has been tried with success stories as well as the failed stories. I mean, there is no good adequate control trial except in the JAK inhibitor as well as in IL-6. IL-6 trial suggested a negative result. JAK inhibitor studies showed a positive results. And of course, the good old steroids, which is one of the good immunomodulator and immunointervention, have saved quite a good number of patients from patient moving into the cytokine storm. Anti-PD-1, probably the immune exhaustion, T-cell exhaustion, if it can be tried and tackled, may also help. I mean, not much studies are there. I think there are one or two studies which is going on. I think we need to wait for the response. I think Dr. Sini Kaveri spoke about the possibility of using adaptive T cell transfers, adaptive NK cell transfers, CAR NK cell transfers, which are probably under trial and should help in improving the overall mortality of the patients who move towards the cytokine storm or severe disease. We have learned a lot of lessons in this pandemic with reference to the immune response as well as with reference to viral disease management. We know that we have very less number of antiviral drugs. We have only one or two or three successful antiviral drugs which can completely eliminate the virus from the infective sites. The one of them is anti-HCV, which we were almost struggling for 5-10 years prior. And antiretrovirals, though we say they're antiretrovirals, none of them are in a position to eliminate the virus, unlike antibiotics. Antimicrobials against the bacteria, antibacterials, where the success story almost touches 95%. Here, the success stories have not crossed more than 5-10%, and most of them is because the host was successful in eliminating the virus rather than the antiviral drugs. Antiviral drugs are still a concept which we have to still work on, but most of the time, it's the host's immune system which makes the way through. And it's most of the time the good adaptive immune response, which make a difference with reference to COVID infection or not just COVID, any other viral infections. Thank you very much for patience hearing.
Thank you, sir, for the excellent presentation on adaptive immune response and COVID-19 infection. No one will say it's a substitute talk. It's
right. Thank you.
Yes, so you enlightened us about the various markers in severe form of COVID, how each one plays a role. I would like to know your response in case of long COVID cases, the immune-driven mechanisms and the line of management, what you'd like to advise to the clinicians.
No, you see, the immune-driven mechanisms, the long-term COVID is also, again, is not something which is unusual. We do see it in quite a good number of viral diseases, and these few of the syndromes have been previously explained. I think one of the paper where we have presented recently, I think, which will be published in August issue of JAPA, we could very clearly show that we used to have a reactive arthritis earlier, and now we have an added reactive arthritis post-COVID, which used to be with few other viruses earlier. And we used to have an immune exhaustion things, which we used to see with the severe dengue virus. And we also used to see with the varieties of severe other viruses, which we are also seeing with COVID. The sequelae, what we are talking of, lung sequelae, were also seen with H1N1. But only thing is, this the only thing which we are not seen in the previous infections were related to vascular complications, which is very typical of COVID because it inhibits, works through ACE receptors. So being the case, if the vascular complications are a little unusual here. What we normally try to use is if it is a short term without any organ or like neuropathy or ophthal or any other involvements are not there, we tend to use just non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug for a short time, and usually patient recovers out of it. And if there is any organ threatening complications like vasculitis or autoimmune features, then we try to use immune modulators like hydroxychloroquine with a short dose of steroids. And if required, in one or two cases, we have even used mycophenolate and other immunomodulators to suppress those auto-inflammatory or autoimmune-driven inflammatory response to bring down the organ damage temporarily. So usually it recedes over a period of 3 to 6 months. I think the longest patient with this problem, what I have seen, is around 9 months. And I think after 9 months of follow-up, her most of the inflammatory processes have settled down. So probably the immune system reconstitutes. As I said, the T cell which has gone off the circulations reconstitute themselves. Once they reconstitute, things should fall back in place.
Thank you very much. So now this talk is open for the discussion. Any questions from the panelists or from the audience? Hello.
So Dr. Chandrasekhar, it's a fantastic talk. You gave very nicely that how innate immune system and adaptive immune system, they contributed to COVID infection. So as we learned from COVID, this is new disease, that there is a strong inflammation. And then when nothing works, then at least suppress the immunity. And doing that, we started trying almost everything which can suppress the immunity. It doesn't matter how strong it is. One of the example you also cited, tocilizumab, you thought that it will be working, but then later failed. So I just want to point out two problem which I have with tocilizumab is one, we learned that TS17 cells require IL-6 to differentiate, and you're blocking that. And TS17 cells also contribute in antifungal immunity. B cell, we know that B cell consume a lot of IL-6. For the antibody class switching and differentiation. I don't know how it was actually thought of, especially in viral infection, that you block the IL-6 receptor. So now you're actually handling two ways using tocilizumab, that you're blocking the B cell differentiation. You're also blocking the TS17 differentiation, which contribute in antifungal immunity. I don't know if anybody has done any study that the patient who has received tocilizumab and fungal infection post-COVID complication. I think it's an interesting area to learn that why these drugs actually, is there any correlation that more mucormycosis related with the some of the specific immunosuppression, and otherwise what we do in general immunosuppression that obviously turn down everything down. So is there anything you are aware of, or if not, I think we need to look into carefully that what happened post-COVID complications.
See, as per the report that are available with reference to mucormycosis in the COVID, they were not able to match to the immunosuppressants or immunomodulators that has been used, because there was no much difference between the incidence of mucormycosis with the patients where we have treated with immunosuppression as well as whom we are not treated with immunosuppression. So that's why it has led us to conceptualize in all possibility that it may not just the immunosuppression, it may be something which is unique what these ones handling or immune responses. So as I showed in one of the slides, actually this COVID has a very peculiar process of leading for a quick immune exhaustion in a susceptible host. That immune exhaustion could be a reason why there could be a transient immunosuppression. That may be the reason responsible for increased incidence of mucormycosis or a secondary infections, which of course we do see sometime in various varieties of other viruses. I mean, it's not something uniquely we see only with this virus, but it is seen in a very high proportion than what we see with other viruses in this COVID infections. And we just need to figure out why it is so high with reference to this. But the studies have clearly indicated that it is not much correlated or matchable to the use of immunosuppressions. I think we need, that's what the current observation has done. We need to wait for, because the second wave observations has yet to come in for us. They're all under the process of writing it up. So we need to wait and see how much clear information comes with reference to these areas. So certainly the immunosuppression has saved quite a good number of lives. I mean, we don't know at all. But has it casted the fungal infection? My answer to that question is, I don't know. We have to wait for that.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
I also agree with Dr. Chandrasekhar. In coming to mucormycosis, we have seen not only IL-6 suppressor use drugs, but also the patients in younger age group, 30 to 35, without any predispositions, without using systemic immunosuppressions, they also manifested with the disease. And mostly, and they develop de novo diabetes secondary to the virus infection per se than using the drugs. What so we have seen in that set of population also, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think we can go to the next talk.
Thank you, sir.